My name is Winston G. Williams, and I am your MC for the hour. I'll tell you that I'm a sweater, and not the kind you wear, hence the towel. I tell everybody, my mother departed this earth hoping that I was going to be a preacher, and this is about as close as I can get. So, welcome to the 20th annual Travis County Department of Human Services Black History Program. It is such an honor for me. I stand before you as a longtime Austinite. I've been here 38 years, attended the University of Texas, and I am now the founder and executive director of the Capital City Black Film Festival. I am the president of Black Professional Alliance. I am the treasurer of Spectrum Theater Company, and I own a consulting company and have done so for 22 years. Those things alone, for me standing here, are historical. And I'd like for you guys to know that each of us have the ability and are making history each day of our lives. So for Travis County Department of Human Services, Health and Human Services, having done this program for 20 years is simply amazing. And I want to give them a round of applause for the consistency. Now we're gonna get the program started, and a few housekeeping rules. Who know what the first one is? Good. Now who's gonna be the one that don't? Seems like a one always goes off. I want to thank Miss Maddie Robinson for our prelude on the piano. She's also involved with Spectrum Theater Company. Give her a round of applause. The restrooms are down the hall and to your left outside of these main doors. And if you could go ahead, and we're expecting some more people, so if you can just go ahead and close in the seats in between so they don't have to cross over you, we'd appreciate that. And now we will start the program.
Yay! Hi, I'm Stephen Williams. I'm currently the director of the Houston Health Department. I've been here about 14 years. But 20 years ago, I was the executive manager of Travis County Health, Human Services, and Veterans Services. Congratulations on your celebrating 20 years of Black history. This started 20 years ago when the staff came to me and asked whether or not it was okay for them to do it. It began by staff actually using the talents and the services that were in the department. Now it's my understanding that you wanted to really make this a big event. I think that it's very important that we continue to celebrate the contributions of African Americans to this country. February is a time to really commemorate the contributions of African Americans to this country, and I think that both governmental entities, private sectors, as well as nonprofits need to do that in order to celebrate the diversity of our country. Oftentimes I think about my experiences at Travis County and smile, because you were certainly a good staff and we made several contributions to the community. I know that you're still doing that under the leadership of Sherry and Deborah and the rest of the administration there. Congratulations on your 20 years of celebrating it. I'm sorry I'm not able to be with you, but I just couldn't turn up a trip to Cuba. I hope you all have a good time at this event.
Thank you.
excellence. Let's give them another round of applause. You see this smile on my face? This smile is because I love our culture. I love who I am. And I hope that others, I'm glad to see so many others here who can appreciate our culture and are here to celebrate with us. Real quick, Ms. Melanie Diggs contacted me to do this for her. And the way she did it was, she sent me an email and she said, "You are going to be the MC for our program." Then at the end she said, "When you accept, I need X, Y, and Z from you." Now, I'm an alpha man and an alpha male. And I'm like, she gonna tell me what I'm gonna do? Who she think she is, Nancy Pelosi? Then I just said, "Okay, Nancy, I mean, Melanie." That was really awesome, again, for the video. Now I'd like to introduce to some and present to others the Executive Director of the Travis County Health and Human Services Department, my friend, Ms. Sherry Fleming. Then it will be followed by the Negro National Anthem by Ms. Deborah Duncan, City of Austin Public Health Unit.
Well, Winston, I know how long you have known Melanie, so I find it hard to believe that you were surprised by that email that you received. All you had to do was look and see who it was from, and then you knew the context, right? Well, good evening, good afternoon, everyone. I think it's good morning. It's still good morning. Good morning. I want to welcome you. And thank you so much for joining us for our 20th anniversary of our celebration of Black History. I want to thank our staff who have annually accepted the charge to host this event. We have had 20 years of commitment from staff and the community to ensure the success of this program. We are blessed in Health and Human Services and in Travis County as a whole to celebrate a rich appreciation for those things that make us unique while recognizing that the fabric of the work that we do is dependent upon the diversity of inclusion of various cultures, ethnicities, and schools of thought. I am humbled by the Health and Human Services team's commitment to creating and supporting this event for 20 years, and I'm appreciative of each and every one of you who has taken the time to be with us today. Welcome, and please enjoy.
I don't know how many of you know that James Weldon Johnson and his brother were responsible for this song. One wrote the lyrics and the other one wrote the music. Both Black men.
With the holy of I just want to thank you all for coming out today and sharing this Black History program with us. I really want to thank all of the supervisors and managers that made it possible for you to be here, because it's not a given. It's never been a given, and that we care enough to learn about some of the things that have happened in our organization, in our community, in our city, and how it has impacted us for generation after generation after generation is really important. It's really important because, I grew up in the 60s and the 70s in Mississippi, and we understood the difficulties that the community had there because they were real and they were violent and they were consistent. You know, now a lot of those difficulties seem to be masked in a way that we don't understand how people are really impacted personally, how we treat one another, how we mentor one another, how we work together, whether we work together. This month gives us an opportunity to share a special perspective, a unique perspective in America. You know, oftentimes I hear that that Austin is not the South, it's the Southwest. Well, Austin was a deep Southern capital in the Confederacy. And if you don't believe me, Google the Articles of Secession, Texas's Articles of Secession, February 2nd, 1861. And you'll get a general understanding of what the perception was of the community, and ultimately how the community has been developed or has not been developed because of those real feelings and emotions. So it becomes our job not only to understand where we come from and why we are where we are, but that gives us a platform from which, because of that understanding, we can grow and build. You know, how long do you want me to stay up here, Sherry? Did you say 2 minutes, or did you say? I'm saying this because I am really troubled. I'm really troubled about where we are in our condition as a city, where we are in our condition as a country. And you waving the flag. Okay. Now I'm told Sherry's the only one that can put that book on. But I'll say this, I'm troubled because I listened to the State of the Union the other night. How many of y'all listened to the State of the Union? And I don't know what you heard, but I'll tell you a little bit about what I heard. He said, look, if we're doing so well now, you just let me do what I need to do. And if you investigate me too much, you're not going to like it. Something's going to happen to you. And these are the types of things that led Dr. King to write his book, Why We Can't Wait. We can't wait because children are dying in our communities. We can't wait because in one of the greatest economies in the history of the world, we still have children that go to bed hungry at night. But the story of Black History Month tells us that some of the things that we're seeing now, we have seen before, and we have found a way to overcome. What it tells us is we've made a way out of no way for generation after generation after generation. But we have to remember that we behaved a little differently back then too. We were committed to one another. We have to be committed to one another. Dr. King was putting together a poor people's campaign when he was killed. And what he said was, poor people have to unite. Our low to moderate income people have to unite. It's only when we speak in one voice that we'll have universal health care. It's only when we speak in one voice that we will have a living wage. It's only when we speak in one voice that we can live where we choose to live and not where we're sent to live. In this community, we were sent to live in a place until that place became so valuable that we were sent out of there too. It is important that we recognize that this is a very significant space in history, and that we need to understand and read our history to understand how we get out of here.
Yeah.
And Joseph Lowery, Reverend Joseph Lowery, kind of put it best, as I've read. He said, you know, a lot of us have fought so hard to get to the mainstream. And what my parents did as they were fighting to get to the mainstream was, you know, take your lunch today. You know, in Mississippi where they taught, if you were a member of the NAACP, you would get fired. You could not be a member of the NAACP formally and work in the school system. The same thing was true right here. But they went to church and they had bake sales and they made sure that they supported one another. And that's fresh water. That's fresh water. So Lowry says, you know, we worked so hard to get to the mainstream that when we got there and figured out that it was polluted, we lost all the fresh water to get us back to where we came from. And we've got to find that fresh water again. And that is speaking the truth to power. That is mentoring somebody who is too young to know better. That is making sure that we are solving problems in this community. We're not just at our desk working. We're thinking about the problems that we can solve and putting the right people in the room, making sure that those things get done. I'm still appalled at the number of rooms where I'm the only brother there. And we're talking about fair housing, and we're talking about public transportation, and we're talking about access to health care. In this environment, that is unacceptable. But it only becomes unacceptable when the folks running those meetings say, I'm not going to have it like this anymore. And when you say that, somebody will have your back. So I do want to celebrate Black History Month. I do want to, but I want us to understand that we are called to a purpose, that our mission is purpose-driven, that there are children who are relying on us, that there are neighborhoods who are relying on us to be the best professionals that we possibly can be. And it is only when we demand more of ourselves than anybody else demands of us that we will make the change that we need. We are still the people we've been waiting for. And I appreciate the time that you've taken to be here. I appreciate the commitment that you have. I just ask you to redouble your efforts. Redouble your efforts, because when you listen to that song, Lift Every Voice and Sing, and listen to the words of that song, you recognize that we've come a mighty long way.
Yeah.
But he didn't bring us this far to leave us.
Okay.
Have a good day.
Thank
you. It's still morning, right?
Yes, sir.
Well, I hate following these Baptist preachers.
I'm praying for you.
Look, first of all, again, good morning. I'm here on behalf of the Austin NAACP, our membership, our board of directors. And thank you very much. And to Travis County, hey, congratulations. 20 years is a long time in this context. Also, Melanie Diggs, this is kind of, for me, incidental. I was at a program planned about People's Court ACC, and she was there while we sung a couple songs. And so she invited me to come over and say a few words, and I promise you, I will. Just a few words. Here's what I want to say. two things. Carter Godwin Wilson, a very powerful man. He had an idea behind Black history. He was very astute on African culture. And here's what I want to say based on his vision, because Carter Wilson was very knowledgeable of African world affairs. And so I kind of accepted his assignment. Here's what I want to say today, in this very critical time, in this large world we live in, to Black folks specifically and other folks generally. There are 1.2 billion Black people in the world of African descent, 1.2 billion. The 130 million in Central and South America, places like Mexico, Honduras, Guatemala, Belize, which is English speaking. Going further into South America, places like, of course, Brazil, the largest Black population outside of the continent of Africa. Places like Uruguay, Paraguay, Colombia, Venezuela, El Salvador, Bolivia, Guyana, Suriname. We are powerful people. Think about their presence. Also, large populations all over Europe. Wilson's thought was, if you knew who you were and where you were, you would know your potential. The word inferior wouldn't exist in your mind or in your thoughts, because you are one of the most significant people in the world in terms of contributions, in terms of science and math. We led the way. So his challenge was, like a jigsaw puzzle, take those pieces that's been a strong part, but you can't see the reality, and put them together when you see the whole. When you see the whole, we are relevant throughout this world. And our primary challenge is, despite where we are today, politically and otherwise, if you see that reality, you will excel in math, you will excel in science, you will excel in music, you will excel in history, you excel in geography and social studies, and many of our kids are. So having said that, I'm always honored to talk about Wilson, his idea, our assignments today, where we're going forward. In Africa today, we have some of the fastest growing economies in the world. Think about America and Africa combining our resources, creating jobs, and also our institutions. We are second to none, folks. So to this program today, thanks for the honor. To Carter Wilson, whose vision is still unfulfilled, by the way. I want to challenge you and invite you in your educational systems, AISD and others, make sure you teach history, us too, geography, and teach math in fundamental kind of ways where our kids can evolve, and that's our job as well. So we are going forward. When we know ourselves and who we are, seriously, there's no stopping us. We were put here to make the world a better place. Look, enjoy the program, I will. Thanks for the invitation. And I'll see you, I'm pretty sure, around the city of Boston, years and months to come. Thank you very much.
Wow. Thank you, Mr.s Linder and Trevelyan, for those inspiring words. I really appreciate it. I love being in the presence of both of these men, and I continue to learn every time they speak. Now, I would like to present to you the Rejoice Dance Ministry from Grant Worship Center.
You know the green grapes.
Come out, come out.
And give you white milk. Mm. But if you think that's something, God's chemical laboratory of redemption took my black soul and dipped it in red blood. And I came out white as snow.
Like saying amen.
Amen.
The angels in heaven then sign my name.
Yeah.
That's just such a deep part of our culture, and I keep talking about the things that I love about my culture. Thank you for that performance. That was quite beautiful. Now I am still so excited. Whoo, man. Now we're gonna have some motivational speakers. I will waste no time reading all of the bios to you, but I'll tell you, our first speaker is Ms. Alta Alexander, owner of Altitudes, an upscale boutique located on 12th Street. Following Ms. Alexander, we'll have Mr. Tyler Campbell, son of the famous Earl Campbell. Both have stories to tell about black excellence through the years. Let's welcome them.
Good morning, everyone. First, I want to thank the Travis County Health and Human Services and Veterans Service, with a special thank you to Melanie Diggs for having me as one of your motivational speakers this morning. And of course, I want to thank you all for allowing me to address you this morning. I'll venture off my course by saying, yes, Mal actually connected with my husband and told my husband that I would be speaking, and I am very glad to be here. So I am actually very thrilled. A celebration of black excellence through the years. It's amazing when I think about how much the human race has accomplished, so much within the past 100 years. We've discovered new things, made technological advances every chance we've gotten, and created new ways to help better the world. It makes it even more amazing how black people have performed and accomplished so much due to the segregated world that was and unfortunately still is around us. Even though black people do have a voice in today's world, most black people of the 20th century and earlier have had to work harder than their white counterparts, that's just a fact, to make a change for themselves and for their country. So in honor of Black History Month, I'm going to give you an abbreviated look at the history of black excellence. In 1929, Carter Woodson, who was just mentioned by Nelson, established Negro History Week in February, which is now where we are today in Black History Month. In 1936, track star Jesse Owens wins 4 gold medals at the Berlin Olympics. In 1956, Nat King Cole becomes the first African American to host a primetime variety show on national television. He appeared on NBC. In 1986, The Oprah Winfrey Show, starring Oprah Winfrey as the talk show host, becomes nationally syndicated. In 2016, Beyonce released a music video for her single entitled Formation. The music video displayed black culture and has since been seen as a beacon, including Beyonce herself, for the Black Lives Matter movement. And just locally, in 2017, yours truly, Alta Alexander, launches her dream of entrepreneurship by opening Altitudes, the first and at this juncture the only upscale African-American-owned women's boutique in Texas's capital city. And I am extremely proud to say located in the heart of historic East Austin. There is a meeting of the minds between what Altitudes is offering the community and what Travis County Health and Human Services and Veterans Service is offering our community. From Altitude's standpoint, albeit through the curation of threads and seams of thoughtfully created fabrics, designs, and styles, empowering others to feel confident even through achieving economic independence and thriving in their workplace and in their life, these are things that are paramount to me. In order to do this, I needed to locate a property in which I wanted to open my shop. In order to do that, I needed to also communicate and connect with shoppers who felt comfortable and safe coming into the location that I selected. I opted to open my high-end boutique literally in the heart of historic East Austin. Again, very proud to do so. And yes, some may categorize this area of our city as one that is vulnerable, but I categorize it as one that is making a comeback to excellence. Yes, yes. And I am very proud to be a part of it. For generations, people from all backgrounds have come to this country with a dream of opportunity, access, resources, and unlimited ownership. But the American dream is a myth for many who have been systematically excluded from systems of wealth building and ownership and lack economic and political power. Taking a page from your agency, we should all look for ways to invest in social and economic well-being to build a shared understanding of our community. You have tirelessly worked every day to empower people through your service to them, always honoring the strengths and differences of individuals and families of Travis County. Excellence is not a destination. It is a continued journey that never ends. Catalyzing wealth and health creation for communities of color must be a national imperative, requiring investment, representation, amplification, and a reckoning of where power sits in American society. We need to be and grow leaders who take a variety of approaches to empower and invest in historically marginalized communities and realize the dream of prosperity is for all. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is an honor and a privilege to be in your presence. And I'm here to act as nothing more than a humble servant for you all with our time together. Miss Tubby, I promise I'm gonna try my best to be on time. My father told me to call her Tubby, so we call her Tubby. But I promise with our time together, I'll be authentic and transparent about who I am, what I come from, and the events in my life that shaped me into the man that you see before your eyes today. But there's one thing that I do, and I do it everywhere that I speak, and today will be no different, requires a little bit of audience participation. So on the count of three, I need you all to yell out TC speak as loud as you can and let my energy and passion be your energy and passion. One, two, three.
TC speak!
Well, let's get into it then.
All right.
I want you to picture yourselves in a doctor's office, a neurologist to be specific, and you are sitting on the patient table looking directly at the door, awaiting the doctor to come in. You're all alone, you're in a brand new city, brand new state, no friends, no family members to lean a shoulder on when you need it the most. And you're in this situation because you have paralysis down the right side of your body. Your equilibrium is totally gone, making it impossible for you to walk even in a straight line. Your speech is gone, making it nearly impossible for you to utter words, so therefore you don't do anything but nod or shake your heads to answer because you are embarrassed by the way that you sound. On top of all of that, you developed a twitch that causes people to look at you funny, trying to figure out what exactly is going on with this person next to me. But I want you all to understand that I am a firm believer that you learn a lot about yourself as a man or as a woman on this earth, not in those moments of triumph when things are going your way. You learn a lot about yourself when you are going through adversity, when you have made a mistake, or you are experiencing a moment of weakness in your life. I'm a native Austinite. I have a mother by the name of Renee, a brother by the name of Christian, and a father by the name of Earl. I fell in love with the game of football at a very, very early age in my life. After all, my father's an NFL Hall of Famer, Heisman Trophy winner, graduate from the University of Texas. But on top of that, he's an official state hero. Here's a little black history for you. By our government legislature, as declared in the year 1981, we had three official state heroes in the state of Texas. After that date, we had four. There's Stephen F. Austin, Sam Houston, and Davy Crockett, and we have the only living official hero of the state of Texas alive to this day. That's my father, Earl Christian. At the age of 16, though, I had a fall from grace. I was ranked the number two running back in the entire state of Texas. Number one was a man by the name of Adrian Peterson, who's in the NFL today. At the age of 16, I consumed alcohol before a basketball game when our high school was playing our arch rival, Austin High, and I showed up there and police officers smelt alcohol on my breath. I was young, I was a minor, I consumed alcohol. On top of all that, I was on a school campus. I was sent by the administration to the alternative education program where I finished the duration of my junior year. No Division I college wanted to take chances on a kid who had an alcohol issue in his past, therefore I lost all of my scholarships. I had to humble myself. And I feel that I heard a man once say that as an individual, it's not until your errors have been made that they serve as your portal to discovery. And I was going to discover what type of man I was. You see, as individuals, when you made a mistake or had error in your ways, you have to learn how to rebuild those relationships of the people you scarred. And you have to live your life in such a way with a humble lifestyle that you can continue to propel yourself out of the situation that you were in. I had to humble myself and go to junior college in Pasadena City College in California. The same junior college that had Jackie Robinson go to junior college there before transferring to UCLA. I got hurt at Pasadena City College. Second game of the season, I wanted to quit, I wanted to give up, and I experienced depression for the first time in my life. And I think it's important as individuals that you have to understand that the failure is not in failing in itself. The real failure is when you fail, if you lack the capability to pick yourself back up after life has beat you down to your knees. And I was reminded of a situation that my father once told me, and it was the first lesson I ever learned as a young man growing up in this world. And he said, son, you are a Campbell man, and a Campbell never quits. Because if you quit at one thing, you will quit at everything for the rest of your life. So I didn't quit. And I worked in the classroom and athletically and still ended up getting a full ride scholarship to San Diego State University that following summer after only playing six quarters of football. Could be nobody else but the Lord up above. I get to San Diego State University and everything was going well until my junior year. And after playing BYU University, I woke up in the middle of the night with slurred speech, paralysis down the right side of my body, and equilibrium gone, which led me to the hospital scene that I painted to you at the very beginning when I approached this microphone. And I was diagnosed with what is called multiple sclerosis, what is known as actually a white woman's disease, if you follow it very carefully, but yet I was chosen to have it. I still graduated on time with my degree in business management. And I was named a captain on my senior football team that year, even had the opportunity to work out for NFL scouts for an NFL pro day. Had the dreams of making it to the National Football League, but I experienced a relapse shortly after that, which ended my career. And I can remember the doctor coming into the room so nonchalant and smooth, and he said, Mr. Campbell, we gotta take the game of football away from you. And I told him, Doc, I said, it's okay, because when one door closes in your life, another one has to open. I did not know what that was. Matter of fact, I waited till my senior year in college to take freshman speech, so I never envisioned myself in this microphone, but what I didn't know was that I was the first person to ever play Division I college football with the disease multiple sclerosis, which meant I was giving hope to a young man or young woman in this world that no matter because they had this disease, it did not mean that it had to define you. And I was giving them hope that they still could. I became an ambassador for the National MS Society, and I traveled the country telling my story. I was told by doctors we wouldn't be able to have children because of the problems that I was experiencing as a man. I have a beautiful and amazing black queen by the name of Shannon Campbell. We've been married 7+ years. I I have an older son by the name of Messiah Christian Campbell, and I have a daughter by the name of Cheyenne Avery Marie Campbell. Don't let anybody step to your face and tell you what you can't do. But when asked, because I'm coming to a close, Ms. Tubby, people ask me all the time, they say, Tyler, why didn't you quit? Why didn't you give up? I said, are you kidding me? My MS is my biggest blessing. But it got me to thinking, what is it about me that won't allow me to quit? And it's in my veins. 5 years ago, our family learned from Genealogy Roadshow, a show on PBS, exactly where that Campbell bloodline started at and where it comes from. After the Emancipation Proclamation was signed, a young boy between the ages of 8 to 10, the first documented Campbell, made his way to Tyler, Texas in 1863. Can you imagine being freed and then coming to the state of Texas where slavery hasn't been abolished yet? My great-great-grandfather was that young man's son, and his name was Julius Campbell. Julius rented and worked land in East Texas in Tyler. Julius then had a son by the name of Burke Campbell, who became one of the few African Americans during the 1900s to actually own and have a mortgage of land of his own. That shows you that relentless work ethic, a vision, and a want to aspire to be something better started way back then. My dad's father, Burke C. Campbell, who was Burke Campbell's son, ended up being present on D-Day, in our nation's historic day, and he served in the Black Army Air Corps, which made him an American hero. Therefore, it should have been no surprise that my father, Earl Christian Campbell, accomplished what he accomplished with his life, because it is learned that I come from a line of kings, a lot of men with grit, determination, and the thrive to want something better for their life. So therefore, here I come, I can't quit, and I can't give up. And I think as African Americans, you gotta look deeply within your soul. It's great to know the people in the history books who've paved the way, but I need you to understand that you also have a history that runs in your veins. And you won't know it unless you get involved with the people in your family and ask Big Mom, ask your grandmother, ask your aunts, ask your uncles to tell you their story. I guarantee you it will provide purpose, passion, and drive behind what you do and the decisions that you make as a man or as a woman on this earth, because a man with purpose or a woman with purpose is a life-changing, powerful soul. Thank you.
G. To Alter, Tyler, and Esprit de Corps, that sequence of words and encouragement and power of expression, let's give them all a round of applause again. And now, we're not done yet. We will have spoken word by Fatima Mann.
Hi, Anna. I believe you. How you doing?
Good.
That sounds like y'all doing good. One more time. How y'all doing? Awesome. Thank you so much. So I am Fatima Mann. My mom calls me Bo, so I answer to both. I'm going to ask the audience for some help here, and then while I'm asking the audience for some help, I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself. Is that okay?
Yes.
Because I don't really believe you. Is that okay?
Yeah.
All right. So Alta, TC, brother, and Miss Melanie. I need a word. One word. From you, when you think of Black excellence, what is the word that comes to mind? Now, while you think about it, I'm gonna give you some time. I'm gonna tell people about myself, and then y'all can give me that one word, and then I'm gonna come back, okay? All right, so a little bit about me. Hey, poetry saved my life, but I'm actually a lawyer, a yoga instructor, and I'm the birther and director of Community Advocacy and Healing Project. So we actually believe that healing is a fundamental right of everyone. And if we're going to change the world, we have to do it from a healing and loving perspective. So we're online, you can Google us, Community Advocacy and Healing Project, and we're on all the social medias except LinkedIn and Snapchat. So Facebook, Instagram, and the Twitters. Oh, and I just turned 32 8 days ago. Thank you. But today is also Sandra Bland's birthday, so she would also be 32 years old. So I wanted to say that. And I can never, ever, 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 ever take a mic without honoring our ancestors who allowed us to even be in this space right now, who worked hard from slavery to even get to the point where we could have our own, you know, mortgages and our own history and our history, right? So I would be remiss if I didn't honor those who came before us so that we can even be our ancestors, 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 because if we keep them alive, then we'll continuously grow. All right, what's your word?
My word is strength.
Strength.
Inspiring.
Endurance, strength, inspiring. We're gonna see what the ancestors have for a poem for y'all, okay?
Strength, endurance, inspiring.
They say seriousness is purpose. Seriousness of purpose equals Black excellence. Black excellence means strength. Strength in an inspiring way. See, most of us don't even recognize that we're our own inspiration. If serious purpose means that we're supposed to be excellent, then shouldn't we involve and then bring up our strength in inspiring ourselves to be the change we want to be today? Isn't history in the present in each moment being something in which we are encouraged to do? See, being encouraging means that we should inspire our reflections to know that we are the strength of our ancestors. Our purpose is serious because our excellence isn't just because we're Black, it's because we're triumphant. We are the beginning people. We are the reasons why there are reasons. See, our ancestors built this country on their breasts and their backs. That is strength, that is purpose, that is excellence. See, aren't we all inspiring? Shouldn't we all be inspired to encourage ourselves so that we can inspire others? Shouldn't we love ourselves in a strong way so the strengths that we have will allow us to be encouraging to others? Isn't Black excellence history in every moment being history and herstory? Shouldn't we devolve ourselves and involve ourselves in being our own strength? See, change only comes when we love ourselves. Change only comes when we have the strength to love ourselves. Change only comes when we have the strength to encourage ourselves. Change only comes when we have the strength to know that inspiration isn't just by ourselves. See, Black excellence means that we are seriousness and in our purpose. We are serious with our purpose. We are serious about understanding the strength in our purpose. See, we all can't be excellent without work. Everybody wants greatness, but wants to put it in a microwave, not willing to take the time for a home-cooked meal. See, we all want things swiftly, but how excellent is swift? See, change doesn't come overnight. Rome wasn't built in a day. Emancipation took 400, well, we still there. We still ain't emancipated yet. Emancipate your mind so that your body and your soul can be free. Strength is a divine dignity. If we're able and allowing and willing to be encouraged and inspired in the strength of all of us, then Black excellence is not just me, it's you, it's all of us, it's the world. Thank you.
You are being blessed today.
Yeah.
Take something away from here. Don't let it go. Thank you. Thank you, my friend. Thank you. Oh, my. Now, we will have a musical rendition by Winter's Black History Choir. Their presenter Storm is passing over and we shall overcome. After that rendition, we will have closing remarks from Melanie Diggs. And I will say at this point, it has been a pleasure to be your MC for today. Thank you.
Take courage, my soul, and let us journey on. Though the night is dark, it won't be very long. Thanks be to God, the morning light appears. And We shall overcome someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe we shall overcome someday.
Today, Janine and I, Janine Smith and Melanie Smith Diggs, want to thank each and every one of you for attending the 20th Black History Program of Travis County Health and Human Services. I must give a special thank you to our executive director, Ms. Sherry Fleming. Sherry's office is directly across from my office. Now, you know, as an executive, she has a mansion of her office, and as a staff, a community liaison, I have a small office, and I have tons of things crammed into it. In that office, I scream, I holler, I fall, I'm fussing, I'm slamming doors. She's next door, so I'm screaming, Janine!
Yelling at me.
I want you to know it's my executive director who says, Melanie, are you all right in there? Melanie, do you need something? And I know she's busy, and I know she has a lot on her mind. Ensuring that we keep our jobs, Travis County. Ensuring that our salaries continue, because I can't go 2 weeks without my check. I'm thankful to my executive director. I want to thank Jeff Trevelyan, Commissioner of Precinct 1. He's making a difference in Precinct 1. I thank him for that. I want to thank all of the participants on the program. I called so many people I didn't know what to do, and I just said, come on, come on, you gotta do it. I want to say something to Tyler. I went to school with his dad, and I was looking for his dad. I said, but I can't get him, I'm gonna get you, come on. By the time this young man and I finished talking, he knew my college nickname. And many of my closest friends knew me as Tubby. Tyler, I did tell Tyler I knew his mother because Earl kept her picture in his room throughout college. The commonality that Earl and I shared, I could eat as much as your dad. It was a Piccadilly or a Wide's cafeteria on Congress in 1974 to 1979. And we hit that Piccadilly, and it was all you could eat. Earl and old boys, Ray Clay and Alfred Jackson, I was sitting right there with the Tubby was eating. Those were good old days. We had each other. We had each other on the University of Texas campus. We came in as 500 African American students under the Health, Education, and Welfare Scholarship. I stayed here and married my husband, who attended HT. I want to thank the staff and the committee. the Black History Planning Committee, it's been tough. The struggle is real. We are still living in a diverse culture. I'm thankful for Travis County. 20 years ago, we fought for this day. We fought for this program. We fought, and y'all need to hear this, the newcomers. We fought to celebrate cultural days at Travis County. The day, the only day that has survived 20 years is the Black History Program. And for me, that's legacy. There are other cultures in our department, and I want you to encourage you to celebrate those cultures. Together at Travis County Health and Human Services, we can make a difference. I want you to know how partnerships work. The Winters Choir were members from staff from Health and Human Services Commission, the state level, where they have called the community liaisons to come out and do outreach for their programs and their resource fair. So I had to call on them, y'all come do something. So they work in the Winters building, and I'm grateful for you taking the time out of your work day to come and share that with us. Fatima, I want you to know it's just been recent in the past 2 years that I've learned that if we want positive change, we have to start loving ourselves. And in 2016, I took a personal journey to start loving Malady Diggs. I'm still tubby, but I'm not nearly as tubby as I used to be. And I've learned that when I am able to love myself and put myself first, then I can share with everyone else more abundantly. There's a young man who was on program who was supposed to be here today. And I talked to his manager at 4:30 yesterday evening. And I told her that we're in the health and human service business. All of us have fallen down, but we get back up. We get back up stronger. And I know some of you know, I have children who are adult, and I cannot afford to judge or talk about anybody else's failures, because I'm constantly trying to prop my own children up. And I'm there when they fail, because I'm mama. So in the words of Michelle Obama, instead of letting your hardships and failures discourage or exhaust you, let them inspire you. Let them make you even hungrier to succeed. So if you have the time, lift that person up who was unable to be here. And if you have a chance, encourage him. Thank you. We have made a way today out of no way committee. We didn't have any money. We have this program, and we have this beautiful facility, and we have a full meal waiting for you. I guess I'll turn it over to Janine now. Thank you, Winston. Love y'all. Love y'all.
Y'all are probably wondering, why is Janine standing up there?
I don't do nothing without her.
Sherry, can you come up and help me? Because this woman right here has put this program on her back for 20 years. She keeps saying this is the last one.
It is. It's the last one.
It's not. Because I'm not going to have anybody to yell at that shares a wall with me. Ask if she wants breakfast tacos.
Every morning. They are good, too.
You made this what it is. It's so special. And every year I come to you and I'm like,
Nobody cares. Nobody comes to these fundraising events.
That's right.
It's like the same 10 people. And I'm constantly begging on emails. Come to the chili cook-off. Come buy desserts. Come to this. And y'all are like, Janine's email is delete. So thank you for that. But I really want to acknowledge this woman for 20 years.
Comes to my office and she says, I am not doing it this year. I am not doing it. I need to pass the torch. It's time for somebody. And I say, okay, Melanie. I said, so just let me know. And not 2 days later, she goes, okay, I'm gonna do it one more year, but somebody has to work with me. And believe me, there have been a lot of somebodies, but I don't know that we would, any of us would have the feelings that we have today or that we've had in 20 plus years without her special touch. And yeah. So as I present our appreciation to you, anyone here who has been on the HHS Black History Committee, whether you're on it now, or you've been on it before, or if you have been a program participant, stand with me as I offer this plaque to you. With our greatest appreciation, we hereby present Melanie Smith Diggs with this award in recognition for 20 years of ongoing commitment and dedicated service to the Black History Program. February 17th.
Thinking we're doing this, and I'm trying to get plaques for other folks.
I've got one more acknowledgement. Dale, I need you to put that camera on autopilot.
That's what I thought you were doing.
Dale, let me tell y'all about Dale. He has filmed for Channel 17 every one of these programs.
For 20 years.
Get here. He puts up with the craziness, us whining. We never have it together. There's all kinds of last minute drama. This year I asked him to pull all the clips from the archives. He was like, what? We're making a video. What? And he did it. And then dealt with me with the clips, and I had the flu. It was a mess. But we got it together. Dale.
Thank you.
Sharon?
Oh my goodness, I could be up here all day talking about Dale and media, but thank you all so much. You guys are very patient, and no matter what we ask you to do, you find a way to make it happen. So thank you so much. Thank you so much. All right, so here's our parents. Thank you.
Let's go eat, y'all.
Moment of silence.
Oh, moment of silence, I'm sorry.
Prayer.
Moment of silence.
Amen.
Amen. Thank y'all.
Y'all work together.